Good evening and welcome to the Sunday night service for February 7th at Bay Springs Baptist Church. We're so glad that you've joined us tonight. I want to welcome you. I also want to mention a few things by way of announcement. If you haven't heard this, we are taking up money for the Wiregrass Hope Group. The way that we do that each year is through the Baby Bottle Drive. If you would like to participate in that, you have until Sunday, February the 14th to do so. So let me encourage you to do that quickly. Also, we've been asking people if there might be any interest in a Zoom Sunday school class or discipleship training class. So if you'd be interested in something like that, please let us know at the church. You can call the church office, you can call Brother Doug, you can call the Sunday school director or the discipleship training director. I also wanted to mention to you that on Sunday, February the 14th, we have deacons meeting at 7 a.m. We have our children's Valentine's breakfast, and that's at 9 a.m. There, want to encourage all of our kids to come out that morning. I think they're having donuts, but don't let me give away the surprise. And then that afternoon at 3:30, our church council will meet. And that day, Sunday, February the 14th, is the day that the baby bottles are due. On Wednesday, February the 17th, we have business meeting at 7 p.m. And then there is a men's pursuit conference coming up on Friday and Saturday of February the 19th and 20th. I believe it's at Ridgecrest Baptist Church. And so if you're interested in that, I want to encourage you to take part. But thank you so much for joining us tonight. Let's go to the Lord in prayer. Father, we thank you and praise you for the opportunity of worship. God, we thank you for our church, and we pray for those who are sick. We pray that they would feel better, and we pray that you would bless our worship tonight. In Jesus' name, amen.
Good evening. Thank you for joining us. There's so many things that the Lord provides for us, and this song that we're going to sing celebrates those things. The peace, love, and joy that He gives us in our hearts. I've got peace like a river. I hope you'll sing with us.
I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river. I've got peace like a river in my soul. I've got love like an ocean. I've got love like an ocean. I've got love like an ocean. I've got love like an ocean in my soul. I've got love like an ocean. I've got love like an ocean. I've got love like an ocean in my soul. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain. I've got joy like a fountain in my soul.
Amen. And we've got all of those things because of what Jesus did for us, dying on the cross, rising again from the dead. And so we're going to sing, I'm So Glad Jesus Lifted Me. This is an easy chorus. Sing it along with us.
I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad Jesus lifted me, singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. I was sinking down. I was sinking down. Jesus lifted me. I was sinking down. Jesus lifted me. I was sinking down. Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound. Satan had me bound. But Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound. Jesus lifted me. Satan had me bound. Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me. I'm so glad 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 Jesus lifted me. Singing glory, hallelujah. Jesus lifted me.
Amen. Thank you so much for singing those songs with us. I hope that they bring you joy on this Sunday night. And you know, the song I'm going to sing this evening, it just reminds us that in our daily life, we have many choices to make. We're constantly making choices about what to say, what not to say, what to do and what not to do, even what to think and what not to think. But whenever we make a choice, we need to make sure that it always leads us to following Jesus. And so I want to sing for you a great old song called I'd Rather Have Jesus.
And be held in than anything this world affords today. He's fairer than lilies of rarest bloom. He's sweeter than honey from Alpha comb. He's all that my hungering spirit needs. I'd rather have Jesus and let him lead than to be the king of a vast domain and be held in sin's dread sway. I'd rather have Jesus than anything this world affords today.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you, Brother Doug. Thank you, Mr. Irwin, for helping us record this service on a Thursday morning. So glad that you've joined us tonight. And if you have your copy of God's Word, I'm going to invite you to turn with me to the Gospel of Mark, and I'm going to read a verse out of Mark chapter 1. I'm going to look at verse 24. Mark chapter 1, verse 24. And the question for the evening is this: is Jesus relevant? Is Jesus Christ relevant? That being said, I want to read to you from Mark chapter 1 and verse 24. The Bible says, I'm going to read verses 23 and 24. Now there was a man in their synagogue with an unclean spirit, and he cried out, saying, "Let us alone. What have we to do with you, Jesus of Nazareth? Did you come to destroy us? I know who you are, the Holy One of God." What have we to do with you, is what the unclean spirit said. And so that brings us to the question, is Jesus still relevant today? Is Christianity relevant today? Is it out of date? Now, I want you to know this evening that I believe that Jesus is absolutely relevant. His day is not over. It has hardly begun. We have everything to do with him, and we have everything to do with him for a couple of reasons. Number one, we have everything to do with him because of who he is. Jesus is the Son of God. He is God's Son. He cannot and he will not be casually dismissed. The second reason that we have everything to do with him is the fact that you and I need him. Now, you may think that happiness comes from things, but I want you to know that the Bible teaches that within every human being, there is a void that only Christ can fill. All right, so what I want to do tonight is I want to mention to you some things that you get when you receive Christ. And I'm going to tell you, each of these things is relevant, and each of these things is important. That being said, let me mention the first. In Christ, you get personal identity. I don't know if anybody's ever said this to you before, but years ago, a person who was pretty significant in my life said these words to me: "I have to find myself." Anybody ever said that to you before? Isn't it amazing that man does not know who he is? We know that because of man's behavior. I read a quote. I don't even have a clue who this guy is, but I want you to listen to what he said. His name is Albert Camus. And I read this quote, and this is what he said. This is what he wrote in one of his books. He said, "The world itself, whose single meaning I do not understand, is but a vast irrational." Now, ladies and gentlemen, please don't ask me to interpret what that guy was trying to say. But here is the confession, I believe, of an intellectual person who has no idea who he is or why he's here. I tell you, I think there are a lot of people in the world that way. They really don't get it. They don't know who they are, and they don't know why they're here. Thank goodness we have good news. The good news of Christianity is this, that we understand who we are in Christ Jesus, and we can understand why we're here. The Bible is so clear that Jesus came to this earth to seek and save those who are lost, to show man his origin and destiny in God, and to reveal to man what life is all about and how it should be lived. I believe that there are a lot of folks who are just wandering around the world aimlessly when the potential and possibility of knowing who you are and why you're here is realized by faith in Jesus Christ. From God, in a relationship with Jesus Christ, you can understand that He made you for Himself, and He loves you with an unending love. This God who loves you has a wonderful plan for your life. And ladies and gentlemen, get this. That plan is beyond your wildest imaginations. I can tell you that growing up not too far from here, I had no idea where my life would take me. I had no idea that I would go to college in Mobile. I had no idea that I would go to seminary in Fort Worth, Texas. I had no idea that I would serve churches in Florida and Arkansas and Alabama. And I think about all the places that God has taken. I had no idea what God had in plan, what God had planned for my life. But His plan was beyond my wildest imaginations. And so if you want to know who you were created to be, then why don't you look to Jesus? Because in Christ, you find your personal identity. But I want to mention a second thing you get when you follow Jesus. Not only do you understand who you are, your personal identity, but you get moral victory. Modern man has mastered the atom, but not himself. Our age has been described as one of intellectual giants and yet moral dwarfs. Now, when you think about the achievements of man, I want you to just sit back and think about all the changes that we've seen in our lifetime. Ladies and gentlemen, I remember before everybody had a cell phone. I remember when everybody had a home phone. I can even remember the wind-up dial before the push button. Maybe I'm dating myself right now. But to be sure, the achievements of man are significant. But despite our achievements in the professional world, the most decent men among us will acknowledge the civil war going on inside them. We are victims of clashing loyalties and competing impulses. There are sins of commission and sins of omission. And both groups of sins, they will haunt and harass us. They will burden us with feelings of shame and guilt and regret. Paul talked about this in Romans 7. This is what he said in Romans 7, 18 and following. He said, "For the good that I would do, I do not, but the evil that I would not, that I do. O wretched man that I am, who shall deliver me from this body of death. We all struggle with sin and death. But who will deliver us? Can education deliver us? Now, ladies and gentlemen, I don't want you to misunderstand what I'm about to say. I do think that we ought to get an education. All right? So I do think that education is important. But you know, the Greeks, they equated sin with ignorance. And they thought that education was the only hope. And I do see that reason is a precious gift from God. And that reason, that education that we can get, it ought to be developed and it ought to be disciplined for the glory of God. But I want you to know that the best education there is powerless to lift a person to moral victory. So who will deliver us? And ladies and gentlemen, the answer to that question is Christ will deliver us. Jesus is successful. John cried out these words in 1 John 5:4. This is the victory that overcomes the world, our faith. So get this now. In Christ, you get personal identity, number one. Number two, you get moral victory. And number three, you get final security. Now I want you to let that sink in for just a minute. In our world today, unfortunately, we place too much emphasis on material security. We all want to know, are we going to have enough money to live when we retire? You know, no matter what kind of contingency plan you have, let me just assure you that there are going to be some things. Can I tell you that I've learned this already in life at 55 years? There are always going to be some things that you did not plan for. They will happen and you didn't plan for them. The fact is that all of us, if Jesus Christ tarries, the fact is that all of us are going to die. And you really can't live with joy and abandon until you've experienced the security that overcomes death. And that security is only available in Christ Jesus. Now, you know, as bad as the pandemic is, bad as COVID is, my goodness, it's terrible. But as bad as it is, let me tell you what would be worse than COVID. And that would be for you to die and not know Jesus Christ as your Savior. Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to listen to me for just a moment. Only in Christ are we secure. You know, Jesus said these words. He said, you must be born again. You must be born again. I'm a firm believer that our churches are filled with people who may not be saved. Now, not my place to judge, but just follow my line of thinking. There are a lot of people in our churches today that fell off a bar stool and fell into a church pew, and they filled out a little form, and they became a member of the church. Well, ladies and gentlemen, it's a wonderful thing to be a member of Bay Springs Baptist Church, but that won't get you to heaven. There's only one way to heaven, and His name is Christ. So let me just ask you, have you been born again? I'm not asking if you're a church member, not asking if you've been baptized. I'm asking you, have you been saved? Because if you know Christ as your Savior, then you can cry out like the Apostle Paul did. He said, for me to live is Christ, and to die is gain. When we are sure that nothing can separate us from the love of God in Christ Jesus, we are secure. So get this now. In Christ, you get personal identity, you get moral victory, and you get final security. I am telling you that if you don't know Christ, ladies and gentlemen, you are missing out on what God has in store for you. Why don't you just do this right now? Listen, there's no magical prayer. The Bible says, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. Right now, maybe you're watching this on a tablet, you're watching this on your TV. Why don't you just look up to heaven right now, bow your head, whatever God leads you to do. And why don't you just call on the name of Jesus today? Ladies and gentlemen, I want you to know He's relevant today. I want you to know that the gospel of Jesus Christ is relevant to you today. Call on his name, because in Christ you get identity, you get victory, and you get security. You get security. You remember that and pray with me in Jesus' name. Father, thank you so much. Thank you for the promise of eternal life through faith in Jesus. And Lord, I'm praying for those folks who are listening to this message right now. Father, there may be one that hears this message and realizes their need for Christ. And I pray that right now they would just call on the name of Jesus and be saved. Father, I'm praying for those who hear this message that are already saved but are not living like they're saved. God, that they would get their life back in tune with you, back in step with you. And so, Father, I pray that you would move freely. God, I pray your blessing upon this church, but not just this church, every Bible-believing church. And Father, I pray that you would move in this country and around this world. I pray for revival, and I pray that in Jesus' name, amen. Thank you so much for joining us tonight. If you've made a decision or would like to speak with someone about making a decision, please feel free to call the church office or call my cell number, call a member of the staff or one of our deacons. We would greatly appreciate to hear back from you. And you have a wonderful evening.